Our first talk or next talk is from Richard Keech from Red Hat.
Thanks, Simon. Good morning, everybody. It's been some time. I have to look at my t-shirt to see the last time I was at a conference here in Hobart. 2003, apparently. But it's good to be back. This morning I'm talking about provisioning custom builds of Red Hat with Kickstart. Let's let the stragglers come in. Okay. Today I'm going to start talking about traditional provisioning issues, building systems with Kickstart, and how I build custom CDs of Red Hat. I should provide a caveat that this is my way of doing things, not the official Red Hat way, so your mileage may vary. One of the things that's emerging out of our emerging technology labs is a project called Genome. This is what I'm about to talk about is not that project. So this is a collection of technologies that Red Hat are working on internally that may or may not lead to next products to do with provisioning systems and so on, but my talk has nothing to do with that. Okay, the background to this talk is I work as a consultant for Red Hat, and the thing I do most often is go onto client sites and they get me to install Linux for them. And I get to see a lot about how they build Linux systems, and this talk's mainly comes out of my own experiences in dealing with that and providing builds of Red Hat for customers. And I should say to start with that, is there anyone here that saw my talk at the Fedora MiniConf last year? Well, you don't need to be here. This is basically the same talk. But I'm glad there's only an overlap of one, so there's a whole new audience except for one. Okay, the way Linux systems tend to get built in my experience is that a base install gets put on, and then someone comes along and does some post-install action. And in some places, the sum of those two things might be their SOE, the standard operating environment definition for Linux in that organization. And then typically there may be some project-specific actions and extra software that gets put on to make that system work for the role it's intended. My observations on this are that it's an open loop process. The last 20%, being this bit, takes 80% of the time. There isn't much capacity to really efficiently leverage the work done on one project on the next one. There's a lot of manual repetition. And the scope of the SOE doesn't encompass project specifics, so the things that are different about one project to the next, you have to do every time. The build state draws upon many different configuration items from many different places. So yeah, you might have configurations for one thing here and another thing there. So you're drawing on different bits that all go together to make the built system. The building, depending on how this process works, for a given organization, this may or may not depend upon the network to get to the end point. And in my experience, it often does at customers. And you as a member of the sysadmin team are at the mercy of the networking team and other teams who go out of their way to make your life difficult, don't they? So many people have seen builds fail because firewall rules are wrong, or routes are wrong, or DNS is wrong, or whatever. So there are external dependencies that may or may not allow your thing to work. Is the, There's an aspect of this which I'll call the accumulated state dilemma. The state of a built system accumulates over time, doesn't it? You know, configuration changes happen after it's commissioned. Entropy happens. It's an open loop process. So there's lots of things that can go wrong. Thinking about the system state of a built machine for a moment, I want to liken the way systems are built to the way code is developed. Program development, you know, progresses from source code to binary executables, and we manage on this side. We manage the source code. We don't go and do binary editing over on the right, do we? Of course not. But typical system provisioning is if you liken the build process to the source code and the installed system to the binary, then we're used to building in managing in such a way as we manage on the right-hand side, akin to doing the binary edits. So the way that I've tried to approach system provisioning is to provide for management on this side as well. In other words, a way of making the builds happen efficiently and quickly, a bit like compiling code. Okay. So that's what that says. Okay. Improved provisioning. Sysadmin and others get together to prepare package profile of third-party software. Okay. Often that third-party software that has to go on there doesn't reflect the packaging approach that your Linux system might adopt. It's nice to try and package everything up into one CD or one nice object that you can repeatedly build. And it's nice to be able to close the loop. So this is how I see it happening. You go and take from some organizational library somewhere a reference build that's already resembling the build you want to prepare for a new project. You test the build, or you update it for your particular target project. You test it, so you loop around here, and then you have a final build. Contrast that to the typical process that I described before, the open loop process. In lots of organizations, the installation only happens once. And then there's lots of stuff that happens after that initial installation, and then eventually the project may get commissioned. So there's a lot of work that's happened between initial installation and final commissioning, and it's anyone's guess as to whether all those steps have been properly captured and documented, and they probably haven't. So the approach that I like to take involves multiple iterations of installation, so that when you finally get to the build that you are going to commission, you know that process works absolutely reliably. Then you've got some sort of quality check at the end. So what you end up with is a closed loop process. Closed loop here, as well as closing the loop here, in the sense that we can take the build of a system for a particular project and then have that captured in some convenient way that we can then submit into some library for verification and testing for use on the next project and so on. Submitting this back into the library allows you to take a template-based approach to provisioning systems. I went past it again, I won't bore you there. Build encompasses everything, it expands up the stack. So what I mean by that is organizations typically describe systems as having a stack of software from the OS up to the applications, plus middleware and everything else. The build approach that I'm trying to describe tries to push that automation, push that encapsulating as much of the software stack as you possibly can into that automated system. And doing that minimizes repeated manual process. And it gives an emphasis on common building blocks, which is always a good thing. Third-party software, no longer a black box to the OS. What I often see in building systems is that the third-party software is often not packaged properly. One of the things that I try to encourage customers to do is encapsulate software that's not built as RPMs and create them as RPMs. So that means that from the point of view of the operating system, that third-party software is not a black box. It's exposed in terms of dependencies and files in the normal fashion for the operating system. If we take this whole process as a given, then we've got a rapid, repeatable build. The changes in the build state feed back into the build process. So it evolves in a way that, a bit like the way code evolves. Rehosting midlife is easier. I'm sure you've all, well, those of you who work in sysadmin know that once a system is commissioned, it's very unlikely that it'll be rehosted midlife because it's just too hard and too risky to go through that process. Whereas if you've got some way of reliably recreating the system as it was commissioned, then the prospect of rehosting it onto new hardware or in virtualization becomes much more palatable. Traditional backups are less necessary in the sense that you can rebuild a machine from scratch if you need, just by going through the initial automated build process. And it's easy to assure that the system state matches definitions. By the traditional process, the open loop process, when you get to the day before you want to commission the systems and the boss says, well, how can you assure me that the state of the system now matches the documentation? Assuming you've got some documentation, even then it's probably going to be difficult. But the system I've got makes that straightforward. Easy to reconcile production and development environments. Well, in commercial IT, in large organizations, you know, invariably you have production and development, test, and often other parallel environments, and making them equivalent to one another is often a challenge. So we need a build process that makes that easy too. So the way that I've approached this, the system that I've developed for deploying to my customers, involves an operating system build, which encompasses Kickstart. If you're not sure what that is, I'll explain in a moment, and uses a custom CD-based approach rather than a network-based approach. That complementary or parallel with that is the idea that if you've got third-party software, try and encapsulate it into RPMs, RPM packages, and incorporate them into the build, and then you script the setup of the whole lot. So for the benefit of those who haven't used Kickstart, and apologies to those who already use it, it's part of the Red Hat installer. The Red Hat installer is a program called Anaconda, and it can be driven either interactively or by a text file. That text file is the Kickstart configuration file. That profile is human readable. It's quite a descriptive, short way of describing the build state of a system, from the partitioning, the language of the locale, root password, package payload, all those types of things that go into defining the initial build of a system. And Kickstart itself can either work across a network or with local media. Install media. So the installation media, that is, the set of packages, can either be on local media or on the network as well. And it provides for a base install plus arbitrary scripts. So you can take a vanilla install and then script additions that adapt that build to your purposes. A typical single custom build CD can include the base OS, the Kickstart profile, third-party software, scripts and localizations, and per-host context, meaning you might have an environment that you're building up that has six hosts, each with a name and an IP address, and the logic embodied in this one disk can know about all the different target machines for your environment. So it provides a ready-to-run deployment, which is fast and repeatable. And as a project deliverable, that disk is version-controlled, easy to install. And I think what I neglected to put on this slide is it's also self-hosting. So as a disk, you can... there's everything on there, on that CD, required to build a new version of itself. So if you want to adapt one project to the next, it's pretty simple. So my recommendations about how you work to build systems are that sysadmins collaborate with others like DBAs to prepare RPM packages of third-party software. Not always possible, but that's the ideal. Sysadmin can prepare and maintain their own custom Red Hat CD. And it provides an easy way to leverage the work done on one project onto the next. So Red Hat provided packages and third-party software packages can meld for highly repeatable, productized deliverables. So, in other words, within an organizational context, you can have what's almost an appliance-based approach to building your machines, whether they be in a virtual environment or a discrete host environment. Leverages the benefits of virtualization. What I mean by that is, one of the things I've found in doing this is I often do the initial work of preparing a build in a virtual environment, and then that same build is targeted towards a discrete host. So you can leverage the benefits of virtualization to make the initial build not require the target hardware. So the way I go about doing this, I keep the standard Red Hat package set for supportability and simplicity. So I don't go mixing up the main directory on the CD, which contains the Red Hat packages, with packages from elsewhere or packages from other releases of Red Hat. It's the standard Red Hat package set. I build multiple Kickstart files from one master using macros in a way I'll show you in a minute. And that gives it a lot of flexibility so that if you want this custom build to encompass builds for a dozen different systems in three different parallel environments, you don't need 36 different Kickstart files. You can just use one. And the macros let those variants be automatically generated. The Red Hat install CD uses ISO Linux to initiate the build process. So I update the ISO Linux config files to show a custom boot screen with a description of the options required to initiate the build. And I'll show you all that in a minute. Boot using profiles mapped. This will make more sense when I show it to you as with that. Get ISO Linux options to post install script for adaptation selections. So what that means is you can pass arguments on the initial boot command line that end up being interpreted by the post-install script, so that there's really only a single point at which you need to give it options, and it goes away and does the rest. Tie it up with a make file to build the ISO. Disregard that. Yeah, make it self-hosting. So that's the point I made before. It's nice to, if you've got one of these CDs, you just use that to build a new one. It's very handy. Okay, instead of launching into this, which looks a bit arcane, I'll just give you a demo. I'm using VMware here. If you see my directory up the top there, I've got an ISO file which is a demo build of this that I prepared for this talk for client one. Built yesterday, Dash 32. It's a 32-bit build of Red Hat, and it's built from this tree, and I'll show you how that build happens in a minute, but I'll just build from it so you can see what I'm getting at. So you can see that the CD is pointing to this ISO file, which is this file here. So if I turn the machine on, okay, boot from CD, and you'll see that it's adapted to a particular project identifier for a particular customer, using a date string as a version, and some basic instructions here. And the way I've got this, there are two build profiles. One's called Linux and the other's called Linux GP. The way I've used it is I use the Linux profile for a normal discrete target discrete host builds. In other words, you're using a real host, and my GP profile corresponds to a simplified partitioning for which happens to be convenient for using a small disk constrained space constrained virtual environment, which I've got here. So in other words, if I'm doing a virtual build, I'll use this one, and the builds can be initiated just by saying the profile name Linux or Linux GP. Then arbitrary arguments after that, typically a host name. So that's it. That's all you need to do. It will proceed and build. It'll take about 5 minutes. While that's going, we'll have a look at what's inside the build tree. Okay, this is inside the build tree. You'll see there's a make file, which you wouldn't normally expect to see in the Red Hat CD build tree. And you've got these files that start like ks.cfg. This is a kickstart profile. So when I booted that, you saw the two profiles, Linux and Linux GP, they correspond to this ks.cfg and ks-gp.cfg. So in other words, we can have one separately built kickstart profile per whatever target environment you want. But these aren't independent of what, these are built, are derived from a single Kickstart file. And that's convenient because most of the attributes of them will be in common. We don't want to maintain two separate files that are 99% in common. A lot of the magic in terms of making the machine adapted to a particular role happens in the post-install script. And likewise, there's macros in there that are expanded when the build happens. So in terms of customizing this, the post-install, this M4 file and this M4 file get used. This is the makefile, and I show it mainly because this is where the main identification-specific identifiers are, the version string, the identifying string. So these end up as attributes that go in various places so that the target-built thing is identified consistently throughout. So you don't have to go and put version strings in different places. This just comes from the one file. Okay. If you we use make ISOFS down the bottom there as part of the build. Okay. Okay. I'm no M4 guru, but I found it useful for allowing me to create multiple versions of a single file with macros. So, in the make file, I'll have a make target like this, KS web. So this obviously, this hypothetical example means a web configuration derives from this file here with the M4, and then we pass M4 minus D web profile. So this defines a macro which ends up being interpreted in a line something like this. So if def web profile, then this line gets input, and that you can have effectively an if then else in lines like this. So it's a way of including or excluding lines conditionally based upon the definition of macros like that. Quite convenient. The other aspect of it is editing the boot message file, including a version string from the make file, and we update the ISO Linux config file, one with stanzas corresponding to each profile. So in this particular example, we would have the option of typing WebGP as a build profile, and although that name is arbitrary, but that profile name ties to a Kickstart name. So this says, start the installation and find the Kickstart file from the local media using this configuration file. Accessing the CD from the post. During the installation process, the CD is mounted under MNT source. So the Kickstart configuration section where a post-install script happens can either be run cherooted or non-cherooted, or you can have multiple of either. When you run a normal percent post, you don't have access to this MNT source. So it's very handy to be able to access stuff off your CD in post-install step, but you've got to do that in a non-cherooted post-install. And you could typically do that, just copy stuff out of MNT source and copy it into somewhere under here so that your main post section gets access to those files. So that's what this describes. The CD is not available from the normal post, so the solution is to copy the stuff from MNT source under MNT sysimage in a postscript indicated in the config file with no cheroot. Yeah. Yes, arbitrary number. Yes. Yes. Pardon? Hi, hi. Okay. You could do that. Okay. That would be equally valid. I guess I've taken the approach of not wanting to fiddle too much with what is happening under the covers, so either would work. This is what I've found reliable install command line. The other trick is to be able to pass parameters through. So at the build command line there, when I said host equals LCA09, to make that available to the post install script is tricky, and it depends upon accessing this. Okay, when the install runs, it has access to that full string in this proc element called proc command line. So you can do something like this. You can hold the state of that in a variable, and then you can parse it using sed and parse out so host equals whatever. This will be captured here. So this variable will end up being the name of the host. So then based upon the host that you passed it, you can perform a case statement and give it its identity. Okay, typically the post install can do things like set the networking properties conditionally based upon the host and the profile, so that when the system gets built, it's fully identified as the target machine. We can create accounts and set account policy, like password aging. We can set default passwords, install and configure third-party software, import GPG keys, finesse services with check config, so you can make sure that the right set of services are running.
Why are you doing all these in
post-install? Where would you... Okay, well, you could do that too. But once the system is installed, it's a question of personal style, I guess. My intention was to encompass everything up to the point that the machine is commissioned. And if you wanted to select a set of services that are running, by all means, you could do it in a separate package.
Well, the thing that helped us with the import GPG keys, one particularly helped us out that way when Red Hat had these keys and had to give a new key on repos. We were able to put that into an update of the configuration package, track it out to the systems, and their updates basically continued on.
Yep. Yep. By all means. Login banners, access control and packet filtering, creating SSH keys, assert kernel tunables, prepare the system for use with RHN satellite if that's your thing. So there's lots of things you can do in adapting a system to be ready to turn on and use restrict root access. So let's see how our build has gone. And so what I'm going to do in this demo, demo part two, is adapt the build, make a couple of quick changes that might be representative of a simple change, leveraging one project to the next, or one client work for one client to work on another client. So we see that our build is complete. I could boot it, and but I'll spare you the nausea of going through the boot process. All that would serve is to show that it does indeed have a host name of LC809. But let's build it again. We'll power off. I'll edit my machine settings. And this doesn't exist yet, but it will do in a minute. Today is the 19th. So we've got client two. Okay, so like I said, this tree is self-contained, so I'll just duplicate that. Brace expansion works wonders. So we'll give that a few seconds. So I've made the necessary identification changes to have this now correspond to a new client. And I haven't actually made any substantive changes within it, but just to show you the point about how an ISO is built, I'll do it now. We just type make. And it's damn quick. So you can see the top one there is the one we've just built. So this is the ISO file. It's not that big. So that's the other interesting thing about this, is that a typical target build for a small graphicless Red Hat build can easily fit on a single CD. This is less than 400 megabytes. And we've got about 670 to play with. So there's plenty of scope there for adding other stuff. Okay. No. That's a good question. I cheated between... you didn't see me actually build this. Between what I'd cheated was I actually took out a Java package from the tree, which I'm going to put back in, just to show you the point. just to satisfy the curiosity, let me just take a slight diversion. I'll do the make back in the demo one, and she'll rebuild that other ISO. So now they should They match exactly. So for the sake of the demo, I'll just make a couple of very small changes and build it. So if we want to put in new packages, then we just put them in the extra packages directory here. So I happen to have a file that I want to add to my build, which happens to be a build of Java, a JRE. I'll put it in the extra packages directory. And for the sake of the demo, I'll say that we've got different target IP addresses for our machines. But clearly, this would be where you'd put the information about the host name. So you could go and adapt this to a particular host. So say our target builder's got new host names. And this host name variable here is what's come from the proc command line. And we select that, and it gets the whole network context accordingly. Yeah, we could change any of those attributes as you need, and then just run make, and as quick as that, you've got a new build adapted to some degree to a new role, a new target, a new client, whatever. So now we power it on. And we see client 2 as the build. So I'll just boot it. And that's it. So this will build to completion. As you saw before, it takes about 5 minutes. And building in the in this virtual environment has some interesting benefits, which I didn't appreciate when I first started doing it. One of those is, as you refine it, often you end up with dependency problems. You go and add a package and fail to account for a dependency of that package. So you want to drop that in to the extra packages directory. But instead of having to restart the installation, the installation will actually fail, saying can't read this file. All you have to do under the covers, while the installs has stalled, you just rebuild the CD, get it to reread that CD, and then have it resume where it kicked off. Have it resume where it stalled. So as a way of iterating the development process, it can be very, very rapid. So that's my approach to custom building Red Hat builds for customers. I know Avi from Oracle has a similar approach for his customers, and I'm sure people here have adapted their own. I hope that you've maybe learned a little bit about or got some ideas that may help you. Any questions? James? That's a fair question. Is there a Red Hat recommended methodology? Generally, a lot of the mechanisms you describe depend upon a network-based approach for installation. And in my experience, it often doesn't suit. I should qualify that I don't use this approach exclusively. I often provision using satellite, which is more the standard recommended Red Hat way. But in situations where you've got an organization that a network build approach doesn't suit, I find this works very well. And a lot of those other methods you describe all assume a network build.
So that the changes that occur during the lifetime of the server are going to be need to be replicated somehow, and you'd need to ensure that the your build system is going to be able to replicate these. Wouldn't it be easier to use something like Puppet or some kind of configuration management system, and sort of because you're going to need that anyway, and you know, like. Deploying. We have the problem of deployment, but then we also have the problem of maintenance of the systems. You know, and being able to have them reappear in a repeatable way. And I was just wondering. That this system doesn't really solve this problem of the accumulation of unreproducible craft?
That's a good question. My build system is clearly targeted at just building systems to the point of deployment, and it can then subsequently work with things like Puppet. So, yeah, it's just not intended to be a replacement or an alternative to post-build management mechanisms, one of which I'll be talking about this afternoon when I talk about satellite. Avi? And so I'll take that as a comment, not a question. Thanks, Avi. The other aspect of this is I encourage people who have this to, if there are refinements to the environment, to feed them back into the custom build CD so that if they need to re-image other systems, then that's accounted for in the custom build. So, And as you can see, that's finished and boot. I think we're out of time, actually. So I'm going to have to call time. So thank you very much.